After today, we're going to be looking at Christmas sermons, messages. How many of you have gone through an experience where you were certain that what you were about what lay in front of you, plan A for your life. Moving straight through, everything's good, plan A is on target, on track, and then something happens. Mm-hmm. And plan A changes. Radically changes. It may be good. What forces it to change may be really good many times. It's difficult. I remember back in the late 1980s when the Lord led me to a point to surrender to the ministry to preach. That was not plan A for me. Just being as blunt as I could be, that was not plan A. Plan A was to continue working in the computer health and technology business, do well there, because I had a whole lot of kids that I had to do well for. And that was plan A. Well, guess what? It radically changed. And I didn't see it coming. We're going to read a story this morning where plan A radically changed. You know, there's two versions of the Christmas story in the Bible. One in Matthew's gospel, one in Luke's gospel. And they're written very, very differently. One is the story, primarily the story of Mary. The other is the story of Joseph. One of them talks about the shepherds outside of Bethlehem. The other talks about the wise men. And the difference is, if you really read them and really look at it, Matthew's gospel is kind of written more from a man's perspective, because he talks about Joseph and the wise men. Luke's gospel is written more from the standpoint of what a woman might experience and understand a little better, because it's a story about Mary and the shepherds. We all know the Christmas story, Mary's story, in the Gospel of Luke, and it talks about the shepherds out in the field. And what was the shepherds, what was their job? To take care of the sheep in Bethlehem, which were used for sacrifice in the temple. What they were to do was to take care of those shepherds, or those sheep, the shepherds were, to nurture them, okay? Well, I think we'd all have to agree that in the majority of the cases, women are better nurturers, okay, than we are, guys. Not in every case, but I think as a rule, we might be able to say that. So there's two different versions of the Christmas story, and each is unique, just like Matthew and Luke were unique in their personalities, in their writing styles. And the Holy Spirit chose them. God chose them and executed that through the Holy Spirit as the Holy Spirit led them to pen the pages of the respective books and letters that they were given. So as we read about Mary's story in Luke's gospel today, we're going to find out that there's a few things we learn very quickly about her. Number one, the first chapter of Luke is a really, really long chapter. There's a lot there. We'll scratch the surface of it today. But we found out a few things about Mary. Her father's name was Eli. She had a sister named Salome. She had another relative in this story named Elizabeth, who was much, much older than she is. The Bible tells us that she was, and I mentioned this, I think, on Wednesday night, or maybe last week, that her husband, Zechariah, and her were of advanced age. Most scholars seem to think between 60 and 80. They end up being the parents of John the Baptist. Okay? But nevertheless, a relative of Mary. What we find out about her, she's young. Most scholars, and I've read a bunch of commentaries on this, that she's anywhere from, ready, 12 years old, some think, to 16. 16 kind of on the high end. So bottom line is, we're going to say she was a young teenage girl. 14, 15, 16 years old. Which, young in that time and in that culture is different than young in our time and our culture. But nevertheless, she's young. Her family was poor, and yet she was a very devout believer of God. Now, the last thing we're going to find out is that she has a boyfriend. Okay? Actually, she's head over heels in love, is what it is. 14, 15-year-old girl, and the Bible tells us that she is pledged or betrothed, your Bible may say, to a man named Joseph. Now, what does that pledge mean? I mean, some people think that it's the same thing as kind of an engagement time in our time. Okay, well, it was a little more than that. Because to be pledged or to be betrothed was legally binding. In fact, the only way it was unpledged was through an act of divorce. And believe me, there were lots of rules and regulations in and around divorce. But they were pledged to be married, which legally was the same as being married. But there was a waiting period of about a year. Okay, and during that year, they're not allowed to live together. So Mary still lives with her parents, and Joseph lives with his parents. Now, Joseph's older. We're going to get to Joseph next week. On the rest, then you're going to hear the rest of that story next week. So they have to wait a year. Okay? They can't live together, and they cannot consummate their marriage for that year, that period of a year. Although, legally, publicly, they are considered husband and wife. Luke chapter 1 and chapter 2, that's what we just talked about, is the background that Luke chapter 1 and 2 unfolds against. What we're about to read seems absolutely impossible, okay? Some people might say gloriously impossible. Y'all get it? You get it, gloriously impossible, okay. If you didn't get it, come next Sunday night at 6 o'clock and you'll, or it's 6, right? 6 o'clock, you'll get it. If you have your Bibles, I'm going to ask you to turn to Luke chapter 1. We're going to read verses 26 through 38. Mary's story, where the birth of Jesus, is foretold. It's predicted. It had been prophesied throughout the Old Testament. We talked about that last week. And now Mary is being brought into the story. Beginning in verse 26, Luke chapter 1. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And he said to her, "Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was greatly troubled at the saying and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God, and behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great, and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. And Mary said to the angel, how can this be, since I am a virgin? And the angel answered her, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God. And behold, your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month with her who was called barren. For nothing will be impossible with God. And Mary said, behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word. And the angel departed from her. May the Lord add his blessing to the reading and the study of his word. Okay. What's happening here is that Mary is pledged. She's betrothed to Joseph. Okay. There's at some point into this year where they have to wait a year. But during that year, guess what she's doing? She's planning a wedding. Okay? There's a big wedding feast. Now, it's been a while since I was involved as a participant in getting married. Long time. 47, 8 years. And I got to tell you, I didn't do much of the planning on it, just being honest with you. But, I mean, think, ladies. The excitement, the busyness, the pressure, the stress of planning your wedding and the wedding feast that is about to take place, that has to take place, as the final step of this union. So I'm pretty sure that that is first and foremost in Mary's mind most days. Okay? She's living her best life right now. Okay? And God steps in right there. He breaks in, okay? And he's about to ask a young teenage girl to do something, to be a part of something that will absolutely change her life forever. He sends an angel. And the angel speaks to her. That's the historical framework that's happening. Okay? So, I always like to, where I can, I like to try and get in the story. Like, try to see the story, if I can, by putting myself mentally that to actually see it happen as best the scripture will allow us to do. So it might have looked something like this. Normal day. Some, what day? I don't know. Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, who knows? But it's a normal day. And Mary's at her house. She's helping her mom, and her mother asked her to go out back to the well and get some water. We need to do the laundry. Okay. Sure. So she leaves, and she goes out in the backyard, heading to the well to get a bucket of water to do the laundry or some type of chore like that. And as she's going through the backyard, to hear somebody say greetings, O favored one. Who is that? And she turns and there's an angel. She sees him. Didn't see him beforehand, but he speaks. And she looks and she says, who are you? And why are you in my backyard? And the angel says, Gabriel, who's she? He did not identify himself as Gabriel. We know his name because it's here in the Bible. She didn't know his name. Doesn't say that. Greetings, O favored one. The Lord is with you. And it says that she was troubled. I got to believe she was troubled. Because about the last thing she expected is to go in her backyard and find some man back there and stops her. I mean, I think about it this way. What if that had happened at my house with my daughter Lindsay when she's 14 or 15? And she's going out back to get something, and some guy's back there. She's never seen him. Wasn't expecting him to be there. He's never been there before. And he speaks to her and says, greetings, O favored one. Let me tell you Lindsay Slade's response to that. She is going to turn and cut back toward that house going, Dad, Dad! Mary didn't do that. She didn't do that. Although it did trouble her, angel says, don't be afraid, for you have found favor from God. You see, there's fixing to be a conversation, and Gabriel is going to do the most of the talking. And she has fairly short responses to the statements that he makes. But with each response, we see that she is becoming a bit more comfortable. And she begins to believe what we would see, and I'm sure she thought was impossible. So he begins to tell her something, and basically it's this. Congratulations, you're fixing to be a teenage mom. Congratulations, blessings to you, you're going to have a baby. And then she gives a little more information, or he gives a little more information. For behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. And of his kingdom there will be no end. Wow! Slow down. She doesn't say, can you go over that one more time? What does all that mean? No. There's a lots of questions she could ask. A lot of questions and comments that we would probably think of. And yet her response is really just, can we get back to that in just a minute? But I do have one question. It's kind of a technical question. You know I'm a virgin, right? How's this going to happen? How is this going to happen? And he says that the Holy Spirit will come upon you. And the Spirit will overshadow you. Holy One will be born. That's the what, the how, and the who of this passage. The Holy Spirit will come upon you. That's the what. The power of the Most High will overshadow. That word overshadow in the Greek means to cover completely, like a cloud, overshadow. And therefore the child to be born will be called holy, the Son of God. That's the who. Well, still a lot to take in. Okay? 2 minutes ago, her life was great. She had it all planned out. It was happening. It was unfolding that way. Plan A, seriously in jeopardy. Okay? Now that this question has been settled, at least from Gabriel's perspective, and she asks, you want to tell me how this is going to happen? He responds in verse 35, and that is the only explanation of the virgin birth in all of Scripture. As big as that is from a theological perspective, from a God's nature, who he is, the story of Jesus, how Jesus became flesh to come down here and live among us for the purpose of dying for us. This is the how that all happened, and it's one verse. The Holy Spirit will come upon you. The power of the Most High will overshadow you, cover you completely. And the Son, the child to be born, will be called holy. Now, some people debate, maybe not the reality of the virgin birth, but some people like to debate about the fact that, you know, God could have chosen. You see, he didn't have to do this through the virgin birth. We're not going to get hung up on that this morning, but I do want to emphasize in this 35th verse that the virgin birth was necessary for God to accomplish his purpose of providing salvation. Okay? It had to happen that way. And quite simply, it's for this reason. Because that's the way he chose to do it. Okay? The Holy Spirit will come upon you. Okay, Mary, this has nothing to do with you and Joseph. Okay? Because she's already reminded him, hey, you know, I've never. And Gabriel's like, I know. God, this will be direct intervention with God through the Holy Spirit. He will overshadow, completely cover. And then depending on what version of the Bible you have, it may say, so the child will be born. Right here, mine says, therefore the child will be born. Either case, that little word so, or that word therefore, okay, would not be there without the assumption, the truth, the reality that those two conditions previously mentioned are in fact true. That's what's going to happen. That's how it's going to happen. And this will be the result. so he will be born. Okay? You know, I think it's kind of interesting that neither God nor Gabriel puts a condition on Mary that she has to understand all of this before it happens. They don't do that. Their only requirement of her was this, that she believe God and submit to what he's asking her to do. We're going to close. For nothing will be impossible with God. Nothing is impossible with God. That verse to me is a verse that is linked to Philippians 4:13. It says that I can do all things through Christ who what? Gives me strength. Okay? It's a word that, it's a verse that we say a lot. This, nothing is impossible with God. God can do anything he chooses, at any time he chooses, in any way he chooses. We don't have to be able to totally understand it. we just got to do it. Submit by faith. Pretty simple faith, really. Now, there's a lot of things that could happen, that could have happened, had she said, no, I like my plan A. You know, we do that sometimes. My plan A is better than God's plan A. Why? Because this one feels better to me. This one I don't know about. Don't know what that looks like out there. We're going to talk about that part of it tonight. Is there a plan A in your life right now that has radically changed? I'm pretty happy with my plan A right now. Although, I got to tell you, I mean, it wasn't, I was kind of wondering, just like Mary, you know, said she wondered about it. I wondered. God's plan A is always better than ours. You know? And he's got a plan A for you. For me and for Mount Pisgah Baptist Church. I don't know that he's going to send Gabriel to your backyard. Okay. But he sends us, his spirit lives inside of us. Okay. This story unfolds before the Holy Spirit had fallen in Acts. Okay, on the day of Pentecost. But nevertheless, the Holy Spirit came. You can read later in this chapter that the Holy Spirit came to Elizabeth. Her, I don't know, her aunt, her cousin, her grandmother. I don't know what the relationship was as far as them being relatives, Mary and Elizabeth. What do you do when plan A gets blown up? And there may be somebody today, here, right now, plan A is blown up. And what do? Exercise the simple faith that Mary did. We all have questions, we all have doubts.
God has one answer, and he's not gonna hide it from us. Okay? Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this story. We thank you for a young teenage girl who was simply willing to trust you. Why did you choose her? Just for that reason. Because you knew you could trust her. Father, help us to understand through this story and experience that we read about. Father, that Mary is the recipient of your grace, just as we are. That she is the recipient of your grace, not the giver of grace. Father, thank you for her faithfulness. And thank you for the fact that you do amazing, extraordinary, impossible things through just normal folks like us. Help us to be available to hear you, to follow you as you intend for us. We ask this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Greg is going to come lead us.